I was talking about this little manual, The Nervous Soldier, and how it shows that the military are integrated, or were in the 1940s during the Second World War, integrated with the medical profession and the public hospital system. This manual for the doctors on the front line was published by the University of Queensland. The authors were John Bostock, who was the research professor of medical psychology at the University of Queensland, where I got my medical degree in the 1980s. And he also was psychiatrist to the Department of Repatriation, which returned soldiers. Of course, this is during the Second World War, 1943. And senior psychiatrist to the Brisbane General Hospital, which became the Royal Brisbane Hospital. And when I worked there in 1980, I graduated in 1983, so 1984, I worked at Rosemount Hospital, which used to be the old army barracks, which had been converted into a psychiatric hospital, public hospital. And it gave me some insight, not at the time, because at the time I thought all the people who were in there needed to be in there, pretty much all of them. We were taught that the residents needed to, that's us, we needed to talk to every patient under our care every day and write some notes in their chart. Now, my registrar was a psychiatrist, he was a psychiatry registrar then. His name was Frank New, and he still works in Brisbane, and he's a very thorough psychiatrist in terms of taking a history. And this is the way I was trained, and unfortunately it's not the way that I have experienced psychiatry. Now, I have been locked up at in the public hospital system more than 40 times since 1995, and my 1995 theories, which got me locked up, related firstly to the pineal organ in the brain. I was claiming that the pineal organ may have had a magnetic sensitivity in human beings the same way that it does in birds and whales, it's believed, and certainly in birds. And that this magnetic sensitivity may respond to the magnetic fields and the electricity in our brains. Now, this was an original theory which was, you know, a bit out there maybe, but not a reason to call me manic and lock me up. Unfortunately for myself and my imprudence, I didn't stop myself from getting excited about my theories. And the other big theory that got me excited was that human beings are driven by instincts for aesthetic satisfaction, aesthetic pleasure, and that this aesthetic pleasure develops in our different senses. And I was particularly interested in our sight and hearing, and that through a curiosity instinct, I basically had a theory that we have instincts for curiosity, communication and play, which is not a radical idea at all, of course, and it's very obvious that we do have instincts for communication, curiosity and play. But in 1995, when I started talking about these things, the biological psychiatry model, which ran the entire psychiatric system, which evolved out of a military psychiatry mentality, there was a strong influence of behaviorism and punishment and, to a lesser degree, reward. Reward was to be given more freedom. When I escaped from hospital on quite a number of occasions over the years, and I noticed when I got my notes through Freedom of Information that I would be listed as AWOL, A-W-O-L, or absent without leave, which is another military term. Now, in 1943, the treatment was quite informative for understanding modern psychiatry. And it's a little book, so this is page 46 to 67, cover treatment. And it starts off with a physical overhaul. A thorough clinical examination is essential not merely to exclude physical disease, but also to create confidence. This is indeed part of the treatment. The more thorough the overhaul, the better the patient mastery. Confidence is 50% of the armory in treatment. You can see the militarization of the language that they use. Now, the physical examination will proceed on usual clinical lines with special emphasis on neurological signs. Attention will be paid to the condition of the pupils, their size, shape, and reaction to light. It will be remembered that a small inactive pupil does not necessarily mean GPI. GPI is general paralysis of the insane or syphilis, but may be due to morphia given elsewhere, right? Morphine. So you can get pinpoint pupils from morphine. Now, this gives you some indication of how they were examining these soldiers, the thorough physical examination. Increased knee jerks are often found in the acute anxiety phase of anxiety states. Loss of abdominal reflexes may be an early sign of cortical injury. The value of a positive Babinski response needs no stressing. Now, a positive Babinski response is where they scratch the sole of your foot with a sharp object and see whether your toe jerks upwards or downwards. In view of the possibility of permanently fixing sensory changes in hysteria, it is wise only to do the pain, heat, and touch tests in those cases where there is a special indication. The elimination of avitaminosis, anemia, and worm infection has already been mentioned. So then they go through the investigation and then the psychological approach. Now, this is actually quite interesting because, firstly, the physical examination that is absolutely necessary for diagnosis of mental problems and for medicine generally. I have never had a proper physical examination in 40 admissions. I have never had a proper history taken from me. That's because the people who are learning how to do the history taking are too busy running around filling out forms and trying to convince people to take drugs than to actually find out anything about the people who are in their care. And that sounds a bit harsh, but I have 40 admissions behind me, and I have been able to see the huge difference between psychiatry as it is theorized and psychiatry as it is practiced. And while they talk about a biopsychosocial approach and so on, they don't ask you anything about your social life or really anything positive about yourself. If you do say anything positive about yourself, it is called grandiosity. Any confidence is called entitlement or grandiosity. So you're supposed to be completely submissive to the treatment. Now, this is a military type, you know, they give the orders and you take them approach. And it says, though, at back in 1943, do not hector or preach, but discuss calmly. For a brief while, forget you are an officer and establish your doctor-patient relationship. Preface your investigations with a few tactful remarks calculated to put the patient at ease. The weather, Melbourne Cup, Sydney Harbour Bridge, fleas or flies are but 5 out of 100 possibilities. Usually it pays to say at the outset that the interview is entirely confidential and that intimate personal details will not be recorded. Now that's not necessarily true, but you're supposed to say that. Now give him a chance to disgorge all his symptoms, nervous and visceral, then minimize. The less said about them, the better. Do not forget that many neuroses are manufactured by doctors who magnify the irrelevant. The commonest personal problems are the family worries, the girlfriend, and the economic difficulties. Well, things have not changed. That is, those are common problems of people in psychiatric hospitals. Family worries, relationship problems, economic difficulties. And injecting them with dopamine-blocking drugs at hundreds of dollars per injection and feeding them Valium, which of course is highly addictive and then causes withdrawal problems and anxiety when you stop the Valium, is not a good way of dealing with family worries and family problems and relationship problems and economic difficulties. I think that's obvious, but the people working in this system, including doctors Bostock and Evan Jones, truly believed what they were saying, and they believed that this was the best treatment that was available. Mind you, this was for soldiers, and they point out that, for example, shell shock, it says it right at the beginning of the book and repeats it, that shell shock, the term should never ever be used, and that it is a misnomer because they were ending up, it says here, the term shell shock should never be used. Already we are seeing at the base returned soldiers who allege that they were told by the regimental medical officer that they had shell shock. We trust that this was untrue and that it was a fabrication of the patient's fertile imagination. What they were saying is that after the First World War, there were a whole lot of soldiers who came back saying that they had shell shock and claiming pensions. During the Second World War, they wanted to make sure that that problem didn't occur. So what they were saying is that it is quite normal for people to develop anxiety during war, and that the best thing that you can do is appeal to, it says here, right at the beginning of the book, motives are all important. History is full of examples of men who have fought and died, sometimes by slow torture, for the things which they believed. Ideals are all important. The success, the greater the ideal or incentive, the greater the likelihood of success. It is the key which unlocks many riddles. It explains why the frail often achieve the apparently impossible, while the physically and mentally well-equipped end their careers in failure. And this is relevant to the Second World War when this was written in 1943. We are actors today in one of the great moments of history. We are called to help free a large proportion of civilization from the enslaving serfdom of German Nazism and Japanese imperialism. No mention of British imperialism, of course. We realize as never before the value of personal and national liberty. This liberty, which has been brutally snatched from Czechs, Danes, Norwegians, Poles, Dutch, and Greeks, has assumed a new significance for us in the face of danger. Hitherto, we took it overmuch for granted. Democracy alone provides the way of life and the form of government under which it can live and flourish. So democracy must prevail, or freedom will vanish from the earth. This is an incentive, this is the motive that should have the power to light the torch of unflagging enthusiasm in us. And today, we of the Anzac Zone have another motive. Perhaps the most primitive of all, that of defending our homes from destruction and our women and children from slaughter. Continues, no peoples ever had a greater motive to inspire them or have faced a grimmer prospect than the English-speaking peoples of the Pacific today. And thus it is both strange and disquieting how often we find great issues sidetracked and trivialities substituted. While our motives for fighting are all important, they must be kept in the foreground and used as a spur to create a high morale which continuous safeguarding will be necessary to maintain. This safeguarding calls for physical and mental activity, for it is doing that is the lifeblood of morale. So